Good evening, everybody. I'd like to call the committee of the whole meeting to order and ask for any disclosure of pecuniary interest and nature of their counsel. Seeing none, we'll move on. Just a couple of things of note. The annual pace of Port Hope comes up, I think it's tomorrow, 11:30 to 1 p.m. at the Port Hope Lions Center. And all proceeds help Northumberland United Way. And I think everybody's well aware of the Farley Mowat Root House, which is a tribute to one of Canada's greatest writers and environmentalists, is being relocated down on the east side of the Gamask River on Thanksgiving weekend. There's a lot of events surrounding it, so a lot of participation. I know it's a busy weekend from a family perspective, but I think that it's going to be, and it sounds like the weather's not too bad either. And also, just so you're aware, the Vintage Film Festival is beginning October the 14th, and that's always a very popular event and can be supported as well. So, just those couple mentions. We have no delegations tonight. The consent agenda, we have 1 through 11. Is there anything that council wants to draw out of that consent agenda? Seeing none, so the Committee of Adjustment meeting minutes of August the 18th, 2016. We have the Port Hope Public Library Board meeting minutes of June 16th, 2016. The Tree Advisory Committee meeting minutes of July 13th. And I'll tell you, it's a different year, by the way. Police Services Board meeting minutes of July 28th. The Economic Development Task Force meeting minutes of April the 20th. Economic Development Task Force meeting minutes of May 18th. Economic Development Task Force meeting minutes of June 16th. Economic Development Task Force meeting minutes of July 20th. The Accessibility Advisory Committee meeting minutes of July 13th. The Cemetery Board meeting minutes of May 30th. And the Parks and Rec and Culture Advisory Committee meetings minutes of July 27th. Could I have a move with this? Councilor Frederick, Councilor Hickey, any discussion on these minutes? All those in favor accepting? Carried. And with that, I'll turn over to Corporate Services, Councilor Frederick.
Corporate Services is now open. Staff report, 1.1, none. Business referred, none. New business, I would like to have our Director of Corporate Services pass along a thank you to the team that did the initial cleanup of all the weeds downtown. We were starting to look like the rural part of town in front of all of our businesses. We've been after them for a while, hadn't been able to do it. Now they will be going through again tomorrow to get up the last weeds. To show you what it did, I was stopped at the Independent by a shopper to say thank you for cleaning up the downtown. So it must have made a significant impression on them. I'd also like to, when it comes up for Parks and Rec, I would like to, and it isn't on there, have a discussion about possibly doing a three-year moratorium on fishing in Ganoresca. Any question period for council? Any questions of the press? Any questions of the public? Seeing none, Corporate Services is closed.
Finance is now open. Staff reports, 2.11, Gina Jackson. Human Resource Manager regarding Labor Relations Committee Terms of Reference. Recommend that a bylaw be prepared for presentation to Council on October 18, 2016, confirming the delegation of powers and duties as set out in bylaw 90/2014 as amended with revisions to staff titles, removal of reference to a Chief Administrative Officer, removal of the Municipal Council Support Resolution form or FIP program applications, and incorporating the new schedule pertaining to the change in composition for the Labor Relations Committee. We have a mover and a seconder, please. Moved by Mayor Sanderson, seconded by Deputy Mayor Burns. Any questions? Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Business referred, none new business. I just want to pass along a thanks to the people from MTAC for their presentation a week ago Wednesday, where we met up at Canton and discussed the impact of MTAC on the rural communities, specifically farmland. It was an extremely informative discussion, and unfortunately, we only had 7 people in attendance, but I'm sure those 7 people are going to play there. Question period of council? Question period of the press? Question period of our audience? Seeing none, finance is now closed. Thank you.
Under planning this evening, 3.1.1, we have a staff report from our planner, Theodore Maripeza, regarding the coordinated provincial plan review. We recommend that the coordinated provincial plan review report be received for information, and further, that the municipality of Port Hope forward the comments pertaining to coordinated provincial provincial plan review to the Ministry of Municipal Affairs by October 31st, 2016. May I have a mover? Councillor Reeves, seconded. Councillor Hickey? Any discussion on this? I'd like to just make a few comments. I think it was a very comprehensive report by our planner, and there have been a number of public meetings with respect to this review. There was quite a bit of discussion about the Greater Golden Horseshoe Growth Plan. This affects the Oak Ridges Moraine, and also some discussion about extension of the green belt beyond the boundaries. And in the report, I just wanted to point out that, as our plan has pointed out, that the draft Greenbelt plan currently it does not include any expansion of the Greenbelt to the east. That means into Northumberland, Corrigan Lakes, for points east. And from the policy perspective, our planner has noted that we have quite a bit of rural protection in our current official plan, and our OP number 7 has just passed, as Theodore presented a report recently on this. And under that OPA 7, we have a lot of strong protections of our agricultural lands, and the whole intent of the Greenbelt is to protect natural resources, and we feel that there is a lot of protection in our current OP with respect to that. If we were in a more urban setting, maybe we would expect a bigger push for the expansion of the Greenbelt. And I know that there's been a big push in Durham for more areas to be protected under that. The other comment is that this public comments has been extended to October 31st. So if there are any comments from the public, I know a few people from the community have contacted me, and I have noted that they can look at the report online and forward any comments to myself or to our planner. And that will be coming forward for any further reviews. I know there have been some other communities that have been extensive reviews of the plan, and I know our planner has reviewed some of those comments from other communities, and she's attended a number of meetings. So I think that this has been a very comprehensive review about how the plan affects this community going forward. So with that, I'd just like to, is there any further comments by committee? So can I have a vote to accept this for information at this time? All in favor? Thank you. Business referred, there's none this evening. New business, I have a number of reports as well. 3.3.1. Committee of Adjustment regarding a notice of decision being file number B0416 for 423 Cross Street. The last date for filing an appeal is Thursday, October 13th, 2016. We recommend that we receive this for information purposes at this time. Can I have a mover? Councillor Politely, seconded. Deputy Mayor, any comments? All those in favor? Is carried. 3.3.2, another committee of adjustment, notice of decision for a minor variance, which is file number A0216 for 423 Cross Street. The last day for filing an appeal on this file is Wednesday, October 5th, 2016. We recommend that we receive this for information purposes. Moved by Councillor Reeves, seconded. Councillor Andrews, any comments? All those in favor? Carried. 3.3.3. Committee of Adjustment, this is for a notice of decision for file number B05/16, being Concession 2, Part Lot 7. The last date for filing an appeal in this matter is Thursday, October 13th, 2016. recommend that we receive this for information purposes. Do we have a mover? Deputy Mayor? Seconded by Councilor Andrews. Any comments? All those in favor? So carried. 3.3.4, Committee of Adjustment, Notice of Application for a Lot Addition and an Electricity Supply Easement for B06/16 for the address at 33-37 John Street. A public meeting is scheduled for Thursday, October 20th, 2016 at 4:35 p.m. at the Canton Municipal Office. At this time, we recommend that we receive this for information purposes. May I have your mover? Councilor Andrews, seconded. Mayor Sanderson, any comments? All those in favor? Carried. 2 comments under new business at this time. I'd like to make sure people know that the Ganaraska Region Conservation Authority is celebrating its 70th anniversary, and there will be a celebration at the Ganaraska Forest Center on Thursday this week at 11 a.m. And I will be bringing congratulations to the Conservation Authority on behalf of the municipality of Port Hope. So if anybody would like to join and celebrate that, you're welcome to attend. It's open to the public. And secondly, as we've had a resignation from the Heritage Port Hope Committee and have not been able to fill that spot on the committee, there will be a public notice in the newspapers and on the municipal website, but I'd also like just to announce that if anyone is interested in applying to sit on the Heritage Port Hope Committee, that there would be great if they could forward an application and deliver it to the municipality. Question period. Any questions of members of council this evening? Questions of the public? Questions of the media first. Questions of the public? Seeing none, planning is closed. Thank you.
Thank you. Under Parks, Recreation, and Culture, under staff reports, 4.11, Jeannie Maidens, Events Coordinator with Lauren Nicolesian, Transportation Operations Manager regarding the Candlelight Walk Special Event Road Closure Report. We recommend that a resolution and a special event temporary road closure bylaw be prepared for presentation to Council on on October 18, 2016, in support of the annual Candlelight Christmas Walk on Friday, November 25th, 2016. That would be mover and seconded, please. Moved by Councilor Hickey, seconded by Councilor Palutin. Any discussion? All in favor? Passed. Thank you. 4.12, Jeannie Baden's Events Coordinator and Warren Nicolesian, Transportation Operations Manager regarding the special event temporary road closure for the Royal Canadian Legion Remembrance Day Parade. We recommend that a resolution be prepared for presentation to Council on October 18, 2016 in support of the Royal Canadian Legion Remembrance Day Parade in service on Friday, November 11, 2016, and further that a special event temporary road closure bylaw be prepared for presentation to Council on October 18, 2016 to accommodate the Royal Canadian Legion Remembrance Day Parade on November 11, 2016. Do I have a mover, seconder, please? Councillor Fletcher, seconded by Councillor Andrews. Discussion, please. Seeing none, all in favor? Passed. Thank you. 4.13, Jeannie Maidens, Events Coordinator, and Warren Nicolesian, Transportation Operations Manager regarding special event temporary road closure for the Santa Claus Parade. We recommend that a resolution and a special event temporary road closure bylaw be prepared for presentation to Council on October 18, 2016 in support of the annual Santa Claus Parade on Saturday, November 26, 2016. Do I have a mover, please? Councilor Andrews, seconded by the Deputy Mayor. Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you. 4.14, Julia Snoop, Community Development Program Manager regarding Leisure Services Master Plan Update Report. We recommend that the Leisure Services Master Plan Update Report be received for information purposes. Have a mover, please. The Deputy Mayor, seconded by Mayor Sanderson.
Any discussion? Council Butcher?
Just a question. I had a resident call me and ask me today about the Garden Hill rinks with respect to, I don't believe that outdoor rinks are mentioned in the master plan, or did I miss that? The question was more pertaining to the fact that there was a Northumberland County information circular, and it mentioned our rinks at Caroline Street and potentially the downtown one, but there was no mention of the Garden Hill rink. So the question to me was, is the Garden Hill rink is part of our master plan going forward, and a continuation of that with respect to the rinks?
Absolutely. I think last meeting, I think our deputy mayor also indicated that a service club in that area was talking about taking it up as a plan as well, and it is in there.
I believe I just want to admit, I don't know why it was not mentioned in the county, and I said to the person, maybe we could have our staff look into the fact that if they're discussing rinks in the community, the convention of Garden Hill one as well. Sure. That was in the county documentation, it wasn't in our
staff. Thank you. Deputy Mayor?
Should also add that at the last budget meeting, not today's, but the previous one, I also put forward that we include some funds in the 2017 budget to assist with that particular outdoor rink.
Okay. Any other questions? Member Garrett? All in favor? Pass. Thank you. Any member of council have any new business? Councilor Boudin?
Are we looking, the Parks Department looking at a moratorium on fishing? I know that we did a great deal of enforcement this year, but the tourism numbers were just massive, and they were here to see the fish, not the fishermen.
Right.
And the advancement this year over last year was like miraculous, but it's still bad.
Okay. I'll just give you some summary numbers that I have today. Just in regards to enforcement, the MNR, they had 437 hours of enforcement and laid 63 charges. Port Hope Police Service Board, or Port Services, had 151 hours and laid 76 charges this year compared to last year. So there was a lot more enforcement. As the Parks Chairman, I put a lot of hours on, Jim did, and our staff. The amount of litter and all those things this year was much better. I don't think a lot of the circumstances have changed, but I know enforcement has changed. But I know Jim is going to come forward with a full report later on with more stats and some recommendations. He's got about three or four options for council to consider at a later time, but he's going to come forward. Jim, have you any idea when you could have a report to come forward for council's consideration on options? Because we don't want to just look solely at a moratorium. I think it would be better as a council to look at some options for the river and for different times. Now that the fishing season has ended October 1st, the numbers have certainly dropped for enforcement and all those kind of things, but we've got some options coming forward. Jim and I have discussed with Parks people, and we've got some options, and he'd like to bring a full report forward with some option for council to consider.
Supplemental question.
Sure.
One of the things that I've been told by a number of people is that our effective enforcement has actually pushed people to Bowmanville, to do the rivers there, and into Coburg. So that, I mean, the problem people are still the problem people, and we seem to have put some check to it, but we force them into other areas. So I'm looking forward to the report. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, this was the first time this council has ever said that we were going to take a firm stance, and I believe we all did, and we put some hard work into it, and I think it did pay off. But we're always going to have this problem, and like I said, I look forward to Jim's report with some options for council to consider, because a full moratorium I don't think is the answer. I think there's other options that could be available that would come forward. Did you have any comments, Jim, you'd like to make in regards to the fishing?
Sure, through the chair. So a number of options will need to be considered, including consultation with the MNRF, as they are the ones that are the governing body when it comes to fishing in Ontario. But certainly trying to look at options that appease all, that being fishermen and those wanting to catch the fish and our residents, certainly. Council does have a number of options available to them should the want be to restrict fishing in Port Hope through the passing of bylaws and in conjunction with the GRCA, as there are a number of properties that the GRCA do own. But as far as changes to the regulations themselves, that would be a, the up to the Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry, but certainly this council could actively pursue that through the ministry to look for changes. But we will be looking at a number of changes, including potentially closing fishing on public lands in certain stretches. We could look at petitioning the government to also look at a catch and release program. And there are other methods that we could certainly look at. But I'll need some time just to consult with the ministry in particular. But I'm hoping to have a report to committee in November, either the first or second, most likely the second committee meeting in November.
Thank you. Welcome in. All right.
Mr. Mayor, did you want to tell us your experiences with fishing in this valley?
Oh, I was too close to those ones. Risking life and limb to chase guys. Just a couple of comments. When you gave the numbers about MNR and our own police force, I mean, it's almost 4-1. It tells me MNR is not being very strong in their enforcement. Maybe giving too many notices. To put in 400 odd hours and get 60 odd and have our boys go out there and girls go out there and do, you know, a third of the hours. And I know that the accessibility of our enforcement was quite good. They responded very quickly when I think citizens phoned, and I think that makes a difference. I'd also indicate that, you know, there's a lot of night work that seems to happen around midnight that needs to be controlled as well. And Jim, I think we did talk about potentially stopping night fishing, because that also is a time when I think, you know, things occur. And personally, I just don't see how it's enjoyable to have 35 people surrounding 150 fish and dangling hooks in them. Doesn't seem like fishing at all.
Doesn't seem like a sport to me either, but as I know in the numbers that I got, the MNR gave out quite a few warnings. In every instant that they were down, they gave out lots of warnings. We said no, we said zero tolerance, and I think our own police service stuck to the zero tolerance a lot better than the MNR, but they are the ultimate. And the thing that people have to remember, all these fines and stuff, all this money goes back to the province. None of this money has stayed here. So there is things like, I know other communities have a fishing permit to fish on public land, like our property. So we could put a permit system in where we recover some of the money that we're spending out, because we are spending out a lot of money. That's been brought up several times between our parks department and extra time with our police service. So this municipality, it is costing us money. And it's all the fines and charges are going to the province. So there is a thing, other communities do have a fishing permit they have to buy solely for the municipality. So that could be another option, but Jim will bring several options forward for the council to consider. Mayor, first, please.
I look forward to, we'll get used to these mics. I did look forward to the report as well, but I'd like to commend that Jason White for walking up and down the banks, you know, and taking corrective measures and literally scaring people away from illegal fishing. He was doing a great job, and it was extremely entertaining for me when I was sitting on there.
Yeah, and on another note, the MNR has put the fishing counter up there. I was up on the weekend with Jason looking at the new counter that's been put in, the $80,000 counter at the fish ladder. And I think the other thing we have to remember is there is a lot of opportunities. There was thousands of people up at the fish ladder on the weekend, and this municipality really hasn't really captured the opportunities that we could with those many people up at the fish ladder. And now that the new counter's there, it's quite a system to watch the fish go through, and they're just working out all the little bugs and stuff now, but it is really a neat system to watch every fish that goes through, and it's being photographed and counted, and it's hopefully going to go live here soon. I think there is a grand opening coming forward, and they're going to have it go live on stream where people can actually watch the fish go through all the time, so it's really neat and very interesting.
And to Councillor Plutnik's comment, on Sunday after the fishing season closed, there were more people along the banks of the river and by the river watching than there were previous to that.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Yeah, I agree. Mr.
McCormick? If I may just add to Councillor Lee's reference to a fishing permit, what some communities have also done in order to try and reduce the volume of fishermen is actually impose a fishing license, but it's a lottery system. So similar to what they do with doe tags and things like that in hunting, where the municipality could actually have a lottery system where people could put their name forward and only a certain number of permits would be issued, and thus reducing the congestion on our rivers and you know the issues that we have with people surrounding pools of water fish. So that will also be looked at as well.
Councillor Andrews first, please.
That's okay, I have you to add.
Okay. Councillor Lennon.
You're absolutely correct. When the M&R announced that we're going to be putting through the camera up there, one of the first things that marketing did is we went to them and said, we'd love to be able to have a feed off of this so that we can put it on the visitor website. Now, the visitor website did put up a small fishing video on it, and it had 41,000 hits within 2 days. We don't market as well, and you're absolutely right, we do need to take greater advantage of it, but it's not for the advantage of the fishing. For the advantage of seeing one of nature's spectacles going. And it is, from a marketing perspective, I understand that we did much greater enforcement, but it also was putting out the wrong message. We're saying, here's how bad it is that we have to have these tickets. It's almost like we're the little speeding place in the highway. You know, it should be something to come and watch the spectacle, because it's incredible. And if we didn't have any tickets at all, it would be absolutely the best way of doing it. So it's going to be a very difficult thing. I look forward to reporting.
Okay, any more questions or comments? Okay, thank you. Questions from the press?
Could you repeat the number of charges laid and contrast the number of charges against warnings?
The MNRF. 437 hours and 63 charges total. Port Hope Police Service, 151 hours and 76 charges laid. Any other questions from the press? Questions from the public?
Jim Rhymes with the Port Hope Lakers Association. I'm just wondering how that the 151 hours affected the police budget, and if that will be part of the report by Mr. McCormick.
Actually, Councilor Andrews.
The budget was $8,000 for overtime for the 4 weekends, and we will be going forward with a like amount next year.
Which gives credence to that idea of a permit. I think it's definitely a need to counterbalance the cost.
Thank you.
Patricia Sinnott, Port Hope. I live on Cabin Street. I have a ringside seat to watch what's going on in the river. And Saturday, I called Port Hope Police Service because people with nets were arriving and going down the riverbank. And I was told by dispatch that several other residents had called regarding similar issues. So I hope you're still collecting statistics, because the problem doesn't end midnight September 30th. There are cheaters everywhere, and it keeps going on. So we need to collect that information too. Thanks.
Yeah. Any other questions from the public for Parks and Rec? Seeing none, Parks and Rec's adjourned for the evening. Thank you.
And Works and Engineering is open for the evening. 5.1.1, Jeanette Davidson, Engineering Services Technician, regarding traffic and parking bylaw amendments at Scriven Boulevard. Recommend that a notice of proposed changes to the traffic and parking bylaw be posted on the municipal website and advertised in the community pages of Northumberland News for the addition of a four-way stop at Scriven Boulevard and Freeman Drive, the addition of a three-way stop at Scriven Boulevard and Ralston Drive, and the removal of the parking restriction on the east side of Scriven Boulevard from Percival Street to Ganaraska Trails parking lot, and further that a bylaw be prepared for presentation to council on October the 18th, 2016 to amend bylaw 39, 2008 as amended, being a bylaw to regulate traffic and parking in the municipality of Port Hope. May I have a mover, please? Deputy Mayor, Seconder, Councilman Blitnick. Any comments or questions on this? Deputy Mayor?
Just maybe some congratulatory comments to the residents who raised the issue to begin with and did a significant amount of research on the amount of traffic that was going through. I also want to commend our own Works and Engineering staff who attended a meeting along with the principal of the school and a member of our police service. All of them were involved. involved in this dialogue, and I think what we've got, and certainly the feedback we received from the neighborhood, is that they're quite pleased with two things. One, the stop signs, but also from a parent's point of view, the drop-off of the children now is in a much safer situation than it was previously.
Thank you. Any other comments on this bill?
All right.
All those in favor? And that will be passed. Thank you. 5.1.2, Jeanette Davidson, Engineering Services Technician and Peter Angelo, Director of Works and Engineering, regarding the Barrett Street Bridge. This is now, we're going to have a presentation by Matt McDonald of Jewel Engineering. Just before we get to that, I'll read what we've got and then we can move right into it. It's going to be recommended that a resolution be prepared for presentation to Council on October the 18th, 2016, authorizing staff to proceed with engaging Greer Galloway to complete a load limit evaluation to confirm the load carrying capacity of the Barrett Street Bridge in the amount of $9,580 plus HST to be funded by the 2016 bridge repair operating budget. And further, the committee provide direction to staff at the October 18th Council meeting on one of the four proposed options noted within this report. So just before we get to Matt, there's really two elements in here that we're going to be discussing tonight. One is the bridge itself, which Matt will be talking about. And secondly, the discussion on the load limit evaluation. So those will be the two things to bear in mind following the presentation. Matt?
Thank you. Again, I'm Matt McDonald from Jewel Engineering.
It's a pleasure
to communicate. So the Barrett Street Bridge, it's doing the end of its lifespan. The municipality is therefore undertaking the planning process for its potential replacement. So just a brief overview of the existing structure. The single lane bridge with a span of approximately 43 meters. It's a Bailey bridge supported on timber crib abutments. It has a laminated timber deck with steel beam guide rail directly connected to the steel superstructure. The bridge was loaned to the municipality by the Ministry of Transportation in 1985. Current age of the Bailey is unknown. It was loaned and it was used at the point of time it was erected in 1985. There is a pedestrian bridge located immediately upstream of the bridge. The average annual daily traffic at the bridge, we did a recent count, I believe it was 2 years ago, was slightly less than 1,800 vehicles per day and approximately 30 cyclists per day. There was also a count of approximately 200 pedestrians daily using the bridge. So we have developed four options for consideration. I'll run through an overview of these four. Option number one is a rigid frame concrete bridge with exposed concrete bridge deck. It would provide for two lanes of traffic with concrete parapet walls with the steel railing. The total estimated project cost of this option is approximately $1.84 million. That's net HST. This is a general preliminary general arrangement drawing for the rigid frame structure that we've generated for this option. I have handouts here that are available if anybody wants to have a closer look up front. Basically, just gives you general configuration of the bridge. It's a rigid frame arch. The previous photo, I'll show you here the previous one. the previous photo that I've showed gives the an idea of what it would look like, rigid frame arch. This is a project we did in Northumberland County in 2015. So it gives you an idea of the appearance that the rigid frame arch would have. The rigid frame arch that we would have in this situation would be quite a bit larger span than what's in the photo that's provided here. So we'll bring up that photo here in a second. We just have to go up one slide. Just go up one slide. Right there, that option one there. So that gives you an appreciation of, again, the option that we would have would be quite a bit larger span, but it would be a concrete bridge or frame arch. The whole bridge would be concrete. The deck would be concrete and exposed concrete surface. So option two here is a steel girder option with exposed concrete bridge deck. Again, it would be a two-lane bridge with inclined leg foundations with concrete parapet walls. This bridge is a bit of a unique look with the inclined legs. This is quite a bit larger bridge in the photo that's provided here, but it gives a uniqueness of the inclined leg approach, which allows us to decrease the girder depth, the size of the girders. It would be a fairly unique structure. The total estimated project cost of that option is approximately $1.8 million at HST. So the previous slide, again, I have more detailed drawings, but they don't view very well in the presentation purposes, but they are available for our copy as well. The photos kind of tend to bring them to life a little bit better. So option number three is a pre-engineered steel truss panel bridge. These are the option again we're considering is two-lane bridge with a box beam railing. The deck, there's a couple of different deck options we could go with a steel truss. You could have a laminated stressed wood deck, or they do make these structures with the orthotropic steel deck with an asphalt wearing surface. That's their more standard deck these days. That is most popular. So the two photos you're seeing there, the one on the left is a single story panel truss, and the one on the right is a two story truss. From our initial analysis, we believe we can get the truss down to a single story, which would be a fairly close match to the appearance of the current bridge, which is the photo on the left there. So that would be a very similar look to it, except the bridge would have a steel deck with asphalt wearing surface. Now the estimated, this is the lowest price option. It's estimated at approximately $1.65 million net HST. So option four, let's skip over that. Option four is another truss option. It's a steel truss bridge. This is more of a custom build. This is a photo of a similar bridge. The bridge on Barrett Street, we most likely wouldn't need the members to be quite as tall as are shown in this photo, but it was the closest match that I could find to the custom panel that you'd be looking at here. We also wouldn't likely need the overhead members that span over in this image. With this option, we considered exposed concrete bridge deck with the box beam railings. This option with the custom truss was the most expensive of the four we looked at, with an estimated project budget of slightly over $2 million HST. So I'm sure you've all seen the report put together by the engineering department. So we're here to discuss the options presented, and if council wishes any tweaks to these options for us to move forward.
Okay, Matt, if you can just keep your spot there, I'm sure we're going to have some questions.
Sure.
And what I'm going to do at this point in time, too, is when the questions come out, I'm going to open this up for you, Matt, to answer, or Mr. Angelo, or Jeanette, to come in on at any point in time for points of clarification. Questions? Actually, sorry, first we have to receive this information. Are there any questions or not? We should do that. So first of all, I'm going to move it. Okay, moved by Councilor Blutnik, seconded by Councilor Andrews. Okay, now we can go to questions and comments. First, Councilor Andrews.
On the steel bridges, maintenance-wise, long-term, or upkeep in terms of paint or rust protection or whatever, versus the concrete bridge, which would be more economical?
That's a good question. I should point out all four options. The Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code requires all the designs to have a bridge life, a minimum bridge life of 75 years. So that doesn't mean 75 years of no work. There's obviously maintenance, as you suggest. So with the steel trusses that we're considering, we would recommend a galvanized steel truss that's not a painted surface. They can be quite durable. Obviously, the more salt exposure, the more salt spray that they're exposed to, there is a deterioration rate applied to that. We've seen them last. The steel trusses obviously have been around a long time. There's one up there now that's been there for quite some time. Overall, there may be a slight decrease in maintenance with the concrete rigid frame bridge because there's elements with the concrete. For the parapet walls, for example, the new trend is to use glass reinforcing steel on the parapet walls in the areas that have the highest corrosion potential with the salt splash. But there's certainly many examples of truss bridges being installed and having long lives. One thing to do with maintenance is to try to keep up on washing your bridges, keeping them clean, things like that are always important.
Councilor Lees?
Thank you. Along with the maintenance part, it always seems like the decking always seems to go. Is it the same comparable with concrete? Like it always seems that we're always replacing the decking on ours all the time. And is that any similarities between that and concrete?
Yeah. The different deck types, the one that would have the most maintenance would be the timber deck. There's a maintenance obviously with that. From there, then you have the steel or the tropic deck, which we've talked to suppliers and they've had those in use for quite some time. They've indicated that in the longer duration ones, they're finding to perform similar to concrete. They haven't been quite as long, around as long. In the concrete rigid frame option, you most likely would do a fairly major rehabilitation after about 30 years where you'd mill the top surface of the concrete off, most likely do an overlay, do any intermediate repairs at that. But the deck itself in the rigid frame, you would continue to rehab that to get the 75 years. You wouldn't replace that rigid frame deck because it's quite bulky and it's quite reinforced. But there's other techniques these days with the waterproofing and the concrete sealers that you can apply. We're finding that decks and exposed concrete and products in general with the applications are lasting longer than they ever have.
Deputy Mayor?
Couple questions. Matt, in layman's terms, a steel decking, what does that look like?
So the steel decking, you actually, underneath, if you were underneath the bridge and you look up, you'd see the steel truss members, and then you just see a flat steel plate on top of the bridge deck. It would be covered up by asphalt, so it would look like any other bridge, concrete bridge with asphalt. You wouldn't actually see the steel deck.
Noise factor point of view, it would be basically equal to the others?
Yeah, essentially. I mean, there would be a little bit of noise. The steel's all bolted down. It would be bolted down tight. You may hear a little bit more of a rattle than you would concrete, but I think it'd be pretty minimal. We haven't had that complaint in other applications.
Thank you. And just the reason for the question was the number of people that live fairly close to that bridge.
Sure.
The next question I'll direct towards our Director of Works and Engineering, or Jeanette, whoever feels comfortable in answering it. In the report on page 3, it makes reference to an addendum to the environmental assessment if we were to go to something that's not concrete. Can you explain to all of us what that means? I understand that we're talking about a 30-day turnaround, or how does that work?
through the chair, I can certainly answer that question. I don't know if Jeanette, I can't see her there, if she would prefer to answer that or not. Okay. So the answer to the question. So the environmental assessment process, basically the preferred approach was to build a rigid frame bridge, option one, if there was sufficient funding. And if there wasn't sufficient funding, that we would then build a single-lane steel bridge. So if the option is something, if ultimately the preferred solution is not to build option one, if it was to build options two, three, or four, then what we would do is we would advertise an amendment to the environmental approvals. We would post that for a minimum 30-day period, and then people would have an opportunity to seek a bump-up request. So if people are not satisfied with that, they certainly have the option to order to petition the ministry to bump that up. So we would want to amend the EA document to ensure that we're in compliance with the legislation.
The other question I had then is, from a timing point of view, how does this fit within the schedule to ensure that we're back on track for the construction period?
Well, we would certainly want to proceed in parallel. And so, again, if we wouldn't want to wait for the expiration of that 30 days, we'd want to ideally give instruction to our consultant to proceed with developing a design for the other option, taking a risk, obviously, that we may receive a bump-up request. But then again, we are running short of time, so we would really like to proceed in parallel with that. And again, maybe Matt, if you could maybe shed some more light on sort of timings, but my understanding is that we want to proceed in parallel so that we can at least get some of that work started. And again, if there was a bump-up request, we would have to suspend that activity and wait for the outcomes of that.
Yeah, ideally we would like to shoot towards tendering the project in the winter time, you know, in the range of February, March, where we get a pretty competitive price at that point in time, with construction looking to start around June, you know, in the June-July period.
And my final question, I'm not sure who wants to handle this one, and that's that with respect to the funding that we've received from the government, the other source, the 50%, where do we sit as far as if we go to a steel bridge versus a concrete bridge, because the original funding was based on the concrete bridge?
So good question. So we have that dialogue with the ministry specifically with respect to that. So if we change the option, I think the ministry representative provided we can still meet the December 31st, 2017 deadline to spend the money. And provided we actually are still building the bridge, there's some general compliance with the EA documents, then they are, I think, still supportive of funding the different option.
Sorry, just one other one. Is it tonight that we're going to be talking about which one we prefer, or are we waiting until next week?
Tonight.
Well, then my preference would be the steel one, and part of it. Yep. Just my comment would be that I prefer the steel bridge versus the concrete bridge. One of the things that's nice about the steel bridge is you can see both south and north of the river itself rather than hide it.
Do we have any further questions, Councillor Letcher?
In terms of the public comments that I heard the most of, the view of the river was a big consideration with respect to the design of the bridge, and the other comments were giving a nod to the existing bridge and the historic context of the Bailey Bridge having been there. So I think that the option three that you've come up with gives a lot of support for continuing with the look, and it seems to meet the two-lane bridge option that we're looking forward to in terms of long-term development. Or maintenance of a bridge that's going to last 75 years. So, but the other, I did have a question with respect to the, when you talk about the deck consisting of stress laminated wood or orthopedic steel deck, are you saying that those are price-wise are going to be comparable?
No, the steel decking will be, in the prices that I've included, that's based on the steel deck. Okay. There will be a slight cost reduction if you wanted to go back to timber. That is an option. But it would decrease the cost a little bit, but your maintenance would increase a bit with a wood member.
Okay.
But it is a possibility.
And in terms of the pricing, because we've heard that there's been infrastructure money given to a new number of communities, and we may be competing when we tender this eventually with other communities, so there may be some price increases with respect to very few builders out there to build these bridges. So in terms of these estimates, how close are we in terms of those numbers? Is there, I mean, I know you've made an estimate information, but is that a factor?
We take it based on, we look at all the numbers every year and all the projects we do, and we try to add a bit of an inflation. Every year the market changes. Again, these are estimates. We hope that they're fairly conservative, but we won't know the final numbers until that tender is closed. But we're fairly confident with them at this point.
Okay, thank you.
Mayor Simpson?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Could you put the number 3 slide back up there so we can see it? I have a couple of questions. One of which is, does the price of the bridge include the ancillary work on the approaches and what have you too, or is it?
Yes, it does. When I say it does include the work on the approaches, it's a very minimal amount because with the options we're considering, we're looking to lower the current ramp transitions. Right now, there's quite a ramp to get up over the bridge. We're working to reduce that and bring it down to a more smooth transition. So I don't have the exact dimension, but I believe it's somewhere in the neighborhood of 30, 40 meters each side of the bridge for the approach work. But that's about the extent of what we've allowed for at this point.
Thank you. And the other question I would have is, when you look at the options that we have in front of us, one of the things that we've talked about and we'd like to minimize is the amount of closure time. Are they affected by the design here?
Well, definitely this option 3 would be the most would be the quickest design. It's a prefabricated truss that will, once the foundation work is done, the superstructure, which is everything from the bearing seats up, will move much more quickly than the other options because there's no forming. It would definitely, I would say, it would shave probably about 4 weeks off compared to a concrete option.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions or comments? The members of the committee? Okay, just a couple things. Peter, I'm going to have a couple questions for you. Looking at this one on the screen right now, shows $1.649 million net HST. I'm assuming net HST means we add HST to that amount, correct? We have another, no.
Sorry. So we pay HST and all, just like everybody else pays you, but we get everybody back on the HST. So when we talk about the HST cost, it includes the abated under 1.3% or something on that order on top of the actual cost. So that includes the cost of HST that we'd be responsible to pay.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so that's fitting in line. So this particular option number 3, as it stands right now, would be somewhat under what we have budgeted. It's under what we budgeted. I believe it fits within the heritage desires of the community. It may not be incredibly old. We actually did try to look at making something close to what was back there in 1980, but then it became very expensive and kind of put itself out of competition. So there's two issues then. So just for 1 minute, if I can do this procedurally, Mr. Comer, I want to put aside just the discussion of our choice, or actually, I suppose we could do the choice right now in terms of options 1 to 4. If I would, is it be okay to poll each member of the committee to get their opinion on this, Mr. Comer? How do you want to go about this?
So the recommendation before council at this point is to give consideration to the 4 options at the October 18th committee of the whole meeting. That's the recommendation as circulated with the agenda.
Okay. So the 4 of them stay on, and so we get to council at that point, that's where we would select the bridge. Okay. The second component of this then is the $9,800 approximately to have a structural analysis of the bridge done. So I'm going to just reiterate just a couple of things. To do this, why would we be doing this? What would we prove from this load limit analysis? Well, we'd do a couple of things. First of all, it would probably take somewhere between 4 and 6 weeks to get an answer back, which puts us in the middle of November. So, or early November anyway. So that's going to be a problematic the first time.
If the report comes back and says, no, you need to close this bridge right now, well, we would do that. Secondly, it could say, we need to reduce the tonnage on this to a certain level. And that level may or may not be acceptable to physically moving traffic across it. We don't know until we get that number. Third, it could say, you know, this could probably take car traffic through the winter. We don't know. So fundamentally, what I think it's important for this council to be able to come to agreement, and I guess this would be at council 2 weeks hence, is to take a look at which way do we want to go. Are we confident that we've got some more life in that we want to spend $10,000? Or are we not confident, and we'll go back to the last concept we were talking about, which was start of kind of the winter consideration, which is the middle of November. So these are the things that we have to address. So if I understand it right now, Mr. Gilmer, then what we can do is we can vote to accept this as received for information, and it moves to a council adoption in 2 weeks' time.
As I mentioned before, right now, and I can read it if it helps clear things up. But, recommending that a resolution be prepared for presentation to council on October 18th, authorizing staff to proceed with the load limit evaluation you mentioned. If it's the committee's desire to put forward with that resolution to council an option, then they do have that right tonight to choose that option, put that forth for adoption at that council meeting by resolution. Ultimately, the way the recommendation reads is that that advice would come, or that direction would come at the October 18th meeting. But if there's a recommendation by committee as to what council should consider at the October 18th meeting, then they could make their recommendation here tonight.
I hope you're clear on that. I'm not sure I am, actually. So fundamentally, we can receive this for information, or we can move it to council for vote 2 weeks from now. I still missed something. I'm sorry.
Yes, fundamentally, and also the component here, the load limit evaluation, is what you're voting on tonight.
Okay. So what I would have to say then is that we need to decide whether we want to do that. So the question becomes, do we want to do the load limit evaluation for $99, or do we not want to do that for $99? So I can entertain comments or questions with respect to that.
We had a study done in the summer on the bridge. Why wasn't that part of that study?
The study that we're talking about is a far more extensive study than what we had done there. I mean, that was not the kind of study that gave you as in-depth of analysis of that steel as this one does. We didn't, that was part of an OSIM study that was done on all 90 some odd bridges. So there, look at the bridge based upon, it's not a cursory examination, but a physical examination of the bridge. That gave an indication from their expertise as to what we should consider for the bridge. If we want to look at a load limitation, then we need a far more dynamic analysis of that steel.
Thank you.
Councilor Luden. I think that we absolutely need to do this for the simple fact that I don't want to be in a position that for $10,000 we didn't do it. I mean, I would like it to fund another branch of the plan, guess we're working so much of this thing, but I'm having trouble with it. I have not asked questions tonight of absolute courtesy. Just not to stir it and make more muddy waters, but I think this would be something that behooves this council to do for the benefit of the general public.
Any other comments? Councilor Butcher.
I understand what we're doing is deciding whether to spend about $10,000 to keep a bridge open 6 months, potentially. Or we decide to, we don't do the study, and then we have to close the bridge in November when the winter season is upon us. Is that correct?
Not quite. I mean, what that means is by doing the study, we get a more determined analysis and we can make a decision as to that bridge needs to be closed on X date roughly. Otherwise, we have to come to a conclusion on our own on a risk calculation scenario when we want that bridge closed.
So we, that, okay, which means that if we don't have a study done, we have to close the bridge because we're not going to take that, that risk.
That would certainly be my recommendation. It would just be a matter of what data we're choosing, yes.
So we spend $10,000 to decide when we're going to close the bridge because that hasn't been determined.
Yes.
Definitively.
Yes. Councilor Plunkett.
They could, after we do the stress assessment, say that we don't actually have to close the bridge at all until we start construction. It could be also one of the things in there where they could come back and say this thing is not in a suitable condition and you should close it immediately. I would like to have somebody that has a little expertise be able to advise me on which way to vote. And the only way I can get that is to spend $10,000. I think it's money well spent.
Thank you. Any other comments? All right, yes. Mayor Center?
I think the agenda is to certainly close the bridge, you know, as short a time as possible. I think from the comments I've heard now, given the budget is such a critical component, you know, I think we can certainly give some direction to where we're going on this, because the difference between 1.65 million, right, and 2 million, half of it being funded means a lot more money in a municipality on other projects as well. And I'm reticent to, at this point, recommend a low study until we actually know which bridge we're going to choose and how long it's going to take. So the amount of time that we're going to close, I think, is a factor. And I sort of agree with Councilor Anders. You know, perhaps when we do these studies, we can add a little bit of a component to it. And I don't know, is this a quote from Greer Galloway at this point in time on the look-in?
Yes, it is. Deputy Mayor?
I'm having trouble spending $10,000 to find out whether we can extend the life of this for another 5 or 6 months. We're going to close it at some point in time to begin with, in order to put the new bridge in. So I guess my concern is, we're in my opinion, blowing $10,000, where in fact we can establish a date and terminate it at that point in time, close it down. To me, the study that I saw this summer, with all the rust and everything else that's happening on the underpinnings of that bridge, my concern is, why are we spending 10 grand at this point in time? Just pick a date and close it, the sooner the better.
Councilor Lees?
This $10,000, I think, is well spent just for peace of mind, because I don't think anybody around this table is an expert on that bridge particularly. And, you know, whether we close it this date or not, I would rather an expert give me their advice on it than myself just speculating. We can all sit here and say, yeah, I look at the bridge this way or that way, but we're not experts. And I think it's peace of mind, and an engineer, you know, this $10,000, I think, is well spent to tell us exactly where we are with this bridge at this time, and we should close it according to what the $10,000 survey says. That's what I think.
Councilor Andrews?
I say we, the critical factor in the bridge is we need something open for the Gannett race. So it can't be removed before that for foot traffic. Okay? That's a very, yes it is, it's very critical. It is, okay, we'll discuss that later, but it doesn't have to be removed until next June, but it can still be operational as a footbridge. So I say, if you've got any concerns, close it now as to what your own works department has recommended in November.
Close it, save yourself $10,000.
Yep. I think where the problem is part of this council doesn't want the bridge closed, part of the council does want this bridge closed. And I concur with Councilor Lees that I don't want to be the one making that decision. If this bridge should be closed today, then let's close it. I mean, if that's the problem, let's just get it over with and close the darn thing. But we have part of this council that doesn't want to close it. Now, I'm sitting down and going, if this thing is going to fall apart, then we should know it's going to fall apart. If it's going to last, it's going to last. I mean, I have no problem having it stay open until June if somebody tells me that's what it's going to do. But if they're going to tell me, I mean, Deputy Mayor, you brought up a valid point. A dump truck with a plow is a whole lot more than the weight that it normally does. There's just a lot of things. But I don't have answers to it. I'd really like one answer to this, please, if we can get it.
Any man?
So if the study for $10,000 says the bridge is in good shape, the question would be why are we spending $2 million and putting another one in?
I'm going to take the challenge on that one. The question of the bridge is not that it's in good shape or not, it's what is its load limitation. That's a different question. So we're asking ourselves around, you're asking the wrong question on this. So in other words, if we're looking, as Councilor Blutnik said, is some of us want it as long as possible, some of us think we should shut it down and mitigate risk. The question becomes one of, I mean, I don't want to spend $10,000 on this either, but the one thing we're doing without spending the $10,000 is we're evaluating the risk as council, and so we need to do that or not do that. So the $10,000, the engineering firm is going to give us an analysis of what we should be doing with that bridge, what its longevity until it gets replaced is going to be. Now, I want to add another note at this time. About 11 o'clock last night, I got an email from Lieutenant Colonel Boychin, Canadian Armed Forces, and he feels very confident that the military will be able to remove this bridge. So that's a big boon to us. There were no dates decided on this yet, but that will probably be sometime, I'm guessing, in around May timeframe. So fundamentally, we're going back to the question that Council Clinton put forth, and that is, does this want this committee on its own want to decide if the bridge should be set down and when that should be? Or do we want to go through a structural engineering that will come back and give us one of a couple of options, but at least something definite? So that's what we need to decide at this moment, which direction we want to take. Councilor Betcher.
We already had a report that came forward as to the recommendation from staff that it should be closed down before the winter season.
Correct.
So I don't know why we're spending more money to get another opinion when we've already received that opinion. The bridge has to be closed for the repair and reconstruction, so it's a matter of we're going to close the bridge anyway, so now we're just closing it earlier to be safe and prudent. And I don't think that we should be spending $10,000 to revisit this again.
And we're going around the table one more time. Councilor Andrews.
It's really amazing now that the short scopes of keep the bridge open and closed, that there are councillors that are suddenly on the side that didn't even want the bridge put up in the first place, coming on site to keep it open. So I find that kind of strange.
Councilor Blodnick.
We're still running into the problem with this council, you're correct. It's presented by staff saying that we should shut it down. This council almost did, and then we decided not to. So we're back at this question again. If we're going to have it open, or we're going to have a professional look at it or not look at it, is the question. If you are going to shut the thing tomorrow, don't spend the $10,000. I'm totally comfortable with that. If you are going to want to leave it open until June of next year, I'd like a professional opinion on whether that bridge is stable enough to do it. That's all it is for me. If you want to close it today, close the darn thing today. That's what staff suggested. We decided to reject that. Now it's before us to say, okay, if you're not going to listen to staff, you have a choice. You have a professional engineering group to tell you whether it should stay open or not. So if you want to close it today, let's not spend the $10,000. You want to keep it open until June? I think that the prudent thing to do is get a professional opinion on whether the structure can handle it.
Okay. Mayor Sampson.
And I think it's okay, this goes around in circles, by the way, because I think there's a lot of public interest in this. I have a question. The $10,000, is it part of the bridge? Could we have that half funded by the government?
Peter?
Yeah, our understanding is that any of the design work and evaluation work can be part of the funding program.
So that would reduce the cost by 50%. The other thing, from the perspective of closing the bridge and how long it's going to be closed, the short time we keep it closed, and I don't think we should have liability for a $5,000 investment now technically. And in addition, we've already looked at and requested to look at, and we've got it back, that we reduce the potential cost of this bridge significantly. And to then close it for a $5,000 evaluation with the safety we've done, I think everybody's done a really good job and the dialogue's been very good. But I would totally support
that we do this evaluation and keep the bridge open as long as possible.
Jeanette, I sense some thoughts out there, so I'm going to put you on the hot seat for a minute.
Sorry, just to clarify that the loan evaluation would not be covered under the grant. It would be funded by our operating budget. It's not eligible expense under funding, so it would be
fantastic. Should have lost it. Thank you, Jeanette. Okay, here's the situation in a nutshell. We have one of two decisions to make here tonight. We say we don't want to spend $10,000, we're going to close it, and we're going to give that a date. Or we're going to accept this report, and we're going to give a date. Now, the timing, as I see it, and Jeanette, you can correct me if I'm wrong, the timing for this evaluation to come in would probably be very close to when we would make our decision to close it anyway, early to mid-November. So the time frame isn't going to make any difference one way or the other. What will make the difference is if you put out the $10,000, and you've got a highly analyzed decision to make, and you know exactly what you're claiming, so that 2 months or 2 years or 20 years down the road, you know that that decision has come from the viewpoint of, we had that completely looked at. And it may come back and say, you know what, yeah, you sure do need to replace that, but you might be able, you could squeak through with certain traffic until the spring. I don't know. So we can put that to a vote. So I'm prepared to put that to vote now. So fundamentally, the vote is to accept as written that we go ahead and we spend the $9,800. So I'm going to put that to a vote now. All those in favor of spending the $9,800? That would be carried. What a jeez,
Dan. We weren't seconded for that, Mr. Gilmore?
We did have it. Already. Bear with me, I've been back to the agenda. Okay. Business referred, none. Yay. New business, none. Question period. Any, I don't know if I should do this. Any questions from members of the committee today? I think you got to go up. Okay, that's good. Any questions of the media? Yeah, I was waiting for that. Yes. Can you use the microphone? Because no one can hear you. Just go ahead and use the mic. You're a pro at this.
I think so. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, so the vote is to go ahead with the Greer Galloway?
Yes, it is.
Okay. You were mentioning the DND possibly removing the bridge. Would that be met? Would you have to pay for that, or would that come under some other federal program?
No, the military would be paying for that as a training exercise, so that actually lessens the cost of the bridge. Now, just to be sure, that is where we're going with this. It is not carved in concrete, but we are leaning that way very heavily. So please don't report that it's an absolute, but we're pretty feeling pretty good about it. Any other questions from the media? Any questions from the public? Bill, Ms. Goldsmith.
Good evening. Does this work?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Okay. Good evening. Through Mr. Chairman, to the committee. Thank you for that conversation about the four options. I think the direction it's going is good relative to our concerns about what was there previously, the nature of the bridge, and the heritage of the river crossing. So whether it's, it doesn't sound like four is on the table at the moment, but whether it's three or four, we would be delighted, I think, with either. I guess the question I have has been partially answered because it seems the resolution you just passed put off the decision of which option until council on the 18th. So that gives us a little bit more time to discuss this. I was considering the bridge designs and wondered if there was a chance to ask the designers if there was a way to reduce the span of the bridge so that either option, three or four, had slightly shorter, less thick trusses, so that it more closely reflected the old bridge. But more than that, as the design you didn't feel quite so enclosed by the size of the trusses on either side. And it might also reflect on cost. So I've done some sketches on ways by which that might happen, either to cantilevering the abutment so that the turning points create a shorter bridge, or through drawing a little inspiration from option two with the legs. Can you brace this intersection of the bridge with legs without diminishing the cross-section of the river flow and therefore causing a damming effect? I know that's probably why you want a wider bridge, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're required to permit a certain flow under the bridge between the soffit and the riverbed.
Yeah. Just to answer you before I forget everything you just said.
Oh, sorry.
A couple of things. We have been looking, and you and I actually have a phone call on it. We have been looking into ways in which that we can keep the trusses so they're not so high. I know that Matt's been looking at doing that. And I'm comfortable that I'm speaking on your behalf, Matt, sorry, that you should have a conversation and give him your thoughts with respect to that. One of the things we have to consider, though, is that we are very time constrained right now. So when we come to this meeting in 2 weeks' time, we need to make that decision and we need to move on it. But your input certainly will be welcomed, as it has been over the past little while. And we can certainly take a look at all of it.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Councilor.
You're welcome.
I can leave these sketches with him now and we can talk later.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair. Before we move out of the Works and Engineering Committee, the recommendation as presented on the agenda has been passed.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to make it known, if there is a mover and a seconder to put forward one of the options to move forward on, that can be considered at this point. Just at this point, the recommendation, as per the agenda, to receive that information on October 18th,
mm-hmm.
Has been passed.
Okay, thank you.
Mark Walter, Caroline Street. I have had discussion about this 2 weeks ago with you. I'm still of the opinion that you had 35 years to make up your mind in this town as to what was going to happen in that bridge. It was put off for 35 years. You have come up to a program that you received approval for funding under certain conditions, that you are going to put at risk if you choose anything other than option number one. I will reiterate what I said last week, or last council meeting. It is not a heritage bridge. If you want heritage, then make it a fort and put everybody down from horse and buggy. That's not going to happen. So put in a concrete bridge, use the money you've got, get her done. With regards to closing down the existing bridge, if you have to close it down, and you'll find out what effects 1,707 cars a day have on the other routes in town. Make a decision. That's what you were elected to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Baldwin. Any further questions?
Julie Longshine, Baldwin Street. I noticed that when the presentation was made for option three, that the consultant provided suggestions for lowering the bridge and the costing for that being less. But on option four, the discussion was also that it could be lowered and it could be changed, but no consideration to change in the cost that was put on the screen. I'm wondering if there's an estimate for that change that suggestion you made.
I'll answer that directly, and then you can talk to the gentleman afterwards. That might well be, but in terms of the percentage of cost reduction, I don't think would be significant enough to bring us into the budget figures that we have.
But in order to give a fair comparison to council and to members of the public, both options should have been presented with the reduction in the bridge, lowering the trusses, and also the costing of that.
I understand what you're saying, but I'll reiterate what I said, is that even with some modifications, my understanding is correct, and Matt or Jeanette, correct me if I'm wrong, is that even with some of those changes, from their experience, it's not going to be significant enough to bring us down to the budgetary figure that we require.
So my next question would be, with the suggestions made by Mr. Goldsmith and provided to the consultant, will options come back to the October 18th meeting with those in consideration and prices estimates provided at that time, so council can see the difference between those options structurally and financially.
Well, right now we have the four options on it. If in fact we can take a look at, if we're looking at option three, for example, with some modifications, if that works out, option three can remain with just some modifications. So that's potentially doable, if I understand it correctly. So that discussion will have to occur, and we'll have to get down to brass tacks on that very quickly.
So, that, am I understanding you then that option three, option four, would come back with some suggestions provided by Mr. Goldsmith to the consultant to show the consultant's option and Mr. Goldsmith's option so that council can see what can be done structurally and financially?
I'm actually going to have to ask a secondary question. I can't answer that directly. Matt, is that a doable thing, or do we even have time or something like that?
Get the microphone here, might hear me a little better. We can certainly look at them as provided as stated. We can look at them as considerations. But I guess to maybe address the questions, with option three, I'm not quite sure if you're referring to the fact that we're looking at the two-story truss compared to the single story.
You said it could be lowered to a single story.
Correct.
And you
yes.
provided an approximate cost.
Yes.
Reduction in that cost of that bridge, but you did not do that for option four.
Yes, so the cost that we provided would meet the single story truss in here. The members would be slightly different for the two story truss. In option four, the photo that you've seen may be a little misleading because it does show fairly high truss, where the truss that we have would be quite a bit lower than the photo. But there was some options that were presented, you know, that we could consider as possibilities, but they have to be evaluated.
Okay, so let me ask you this then. Fundamentally, we still keep the four options that were being presented tonight with the potential slight modifications.
Yeah.
Is that a doable thing?
Sure.
Okay. Fundamentally, we're working on for councils. We're working on the same four options. There just may be some slight modifications in the cost of one. Hopefully done. Okay. Thank you. Any further questions from the members of the audience this evening? That works in engineering is closed.
Police and fire services now open. Staff reports none. Business referred none. New business, just a couple things. One, on behalf of my fellow members of council, I'd like to express our sincere appreciation for the fact that Councillor Fletcher was able to keep her eyes open for the entire time you were here tonight. She's just returned from Japan with a 15-hour, I think, difference in time zone, so congratulations. Second item, on a fun kind of thing, last Saturday I represented council at the Kawartha Northumberland Butter Tart Taste-Off, and I was one of the five judges that judged the butter tarts that were presented to us. I was not expecting a large board, approximately 3 feet long by about a foot deep, with 16 tarts. So I did step up to the plate, so to speak, and did my job, and in fact chose the ultimate winner, which was Dudu's son of Baby Girl. So thank you. Luckily enough, my wife came with me. She was the driver on the way home because I had a buzz for about 3.5 hours. Question period. Any questions from members of the committee? Any questions from me? Any questions from members of the public? Seeing none, police and fire services close for the evening.
Thank you, and thank you for your patience through the dialogue, particularly on the bridge and the fish. That's a piece to discuss. I look forward to moving forward, and with that, I adjourn the meeting. Thank you very much.